Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to that light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my
little guys are going down. I don't know who bought Ava that toy, but I appreciate it. I don't even know where it came from. Amen. It pops whenever it rolls. I love that song. I'm telling you what, Miss Kayette, you bless me. Lead me home. Huh? Elvis. I thought it sounded familiar there. No, we used to sing that at Fairhaven all the time. Well, I wouldn't say we. But somebody sang it at Fairhaven. I can't remember who. I believe it was Miss Jean Sword. And it just brings me back to the day when I gave my heart to Jesus. And you can always, it's amazing how little things like that will just bring you back to that moment in time. And then the devil tries to hijack it with your kids, amen. But y'all know how that is. Galatians chapter number 6, Galatians chapter number 6. I'm gonna take that cough drop out of there so I don't get in trouble, just in case my mom watches at home tonight. Her and dad get on Facebook together now. It's kind of funny. And every now and then I'll notice they'll say something that I said, and I'm like, I never said that at your church. And then I realized they've figured out how to live stream now. So now I really have to watch what I'm saying and make sure that everything I say is full truth, nothing but the truth, or I'm going to get whipped. Amen? I don't think my dad has ever thrown his paddle away. It still has my name on it 15 times, my sister's name on it once, my brother's name on it another 13 times. So my sister's name, did I mention my sister's name's only on there once? That's because my name's on there 15 times for hers. Galatians chapter number 6. I have enjoyed teaching through this. I've learned so much personally. And I was going to end tonight, and I'm going to end Wednesday nights of Galatians, but this Sunday night I'm going to preach one last time, well, not one last time, but one more time from Galatians, because at the very end of this chapter, in the salutations, God showed me something about a man's character and his thought processes that I believe that would do every one of us some good. So Sunday night I'm going to preach on that. But tonight I want to teach out of Galatians chapter number 6. And if you're able to stand for the reading of God's Word, that'd be great. And if you can't, that's fine too. But we're going to stand here for Galatians chapter 6. And we're going to look at the law of life in Christ. We've discussed the law of liberty. We've discussed the law of the likeness to Christ and how we need to be like Him. But we also, last week we looked at the law of love in Christ. And here's the last law, the law of life. The Bible says this, "Be not deceived," verse 7, "God is not mocked, for whatsoever man soweth, he also reap. For he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life." Let's say that. Let's look at that again. "But he that soweth the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith." Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being so good to us. Lord, we thank you for all these kids. Lord, I know that sometimes it gets overwhelming here on Wednesday night for some people. And they don't get the chaos is okay. And it gets a little crazy in here because there are kids that are learning that a whole entire church cares enough for them to set things back a little bit and do things different just for them. And Lord, I pray, God, that we could raise these kids up in a way that is pleasing to you. Lord, I ask you, God, that you'd take your word and you'd create in us new creatures. That you'd build us to be examples to the next generation. Lord, I pray tonight that you'd empty me of self and sin. I ask you that you let me walk in the Spirit fully filled. Lord, it's the Super Bowl. And I ask you, God, together, let's leave, no doubt. In Jesus' name, amen, and you may be seated. Life in Christ may be one of the most important themes out of the book of Galatians. It is a central theme throughout all of the Bible. The Bible brings us to a point where we are able to live in Christ, and we can realize that we have a better life when we do live in Christ. You see, there is no greater truth than understanding that the thief cometh to steal, but for to steal and to kill. But he come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. You see, abundant life comes from a life that is in Christ. I have noticed, though, that everybody wants to claim an abundant life without living in Christ. You see, but Paul wants us to realize that if we're going to live in Christ, there are some things that we need to exemplify in our character, in our being, in our everyday walk and talk. And I believe this, that every Christian will exemplify a life in Christ by following these simple truths. Number one, the Bible says in verse 7, be not deceived. I like how it begins there. Don't be fooled. Don't be hoodwinked. Don't let somebody make a fool out of you. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. And I believe this, that everybody in here who is a finger pointer doesn't like this verse. Amen? Everybody in here who is a comparative Christian doesn't like this verse. Because everybody in here who looks at everybody else and says, well, they get to do this, and they get to do this, and they get to live like this, is all brought into one thought here, that you shouldn't be deceived by those thoughts, because God's not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So living in Christ is formulated on this, the soil. Amen? The soil. You say, what are you getting there, preacher? I'm getting this, that we see that every Christian likes to use the context of a life or the law of liberty. How many people has ever seen somebody do something wrong only for them to say, well, don't I have liberty in Christ to do this? Amen. I grew up and one of the biggest verses that I grew up, and I went to Fairhaven Baptist Church. They had Fairhaven Christian School. Some of my best friends were from Fairhaven Christian School, and they learned a verse that I didn't learn. It was 1 John 1:9. Right? They learned that if they confess their sin, that He's faithful and just to forgive them their sin and to cleanse them from all unrighteousness. We'd be hanging out, and some of these same characters would be doing the same things that I was doing, which none of us should have been doing. But they would say, well, if we confess our sins, we're faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I'd look at them. Next thing I know, Miss Kay, I'd start getting in trouble at home, and mom and dad would go to beat me, and I'd look at them and says, 1 John 1:9. And they'd look at me like this. I said, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I began to develop a poor habit of any time I got in trouble, I got out the old credit card. Liberty. And I'd take it. I'd take it out every chance I'd get. And I'd swipe it as much as I could. But I found out something. What a man sows, he also reaps. I learned this lesson again later on in life after we got married. I started working out of town a lot, and they gave you per diem, and you got $33 a day per diem. That was including your hotel, you know, because you can get a hotel for $33. Amen. And your meal. So we took our $33 and we got our hotel and whatever, and I'd always put it on my credit card, and I'd say, when I get my per diem check, I'll pay back my credit card. So about 15, 11 months later, hey Ben, we got the bill. And Sydney looked at me and said, have you been paying the credit card? I said, no, it's a credit card. You just pay it when you want to. And she made me realize, she taught me a lesson that 12% adds up. And I started thinking about this, and I started thinking about us who use our Christian credit cards every chance that we can. The more you use it, the more things build up between you and God, and that liberty that you were afforded before, you will be reaping the bills later. And I believe this, that there are Christians who walk around swiping their card every chance they get and using the law of liberty only to find out that when the bills come, that they don't have any spiritual money in the bank to pay it. Amen? Because you gotta pay it. You've got to pay that. But it starts in your living. You see, living in a Christian life, or living in Christ, is formulated in the soil. That is the person. The person who lives in Christ will be faithful. Amen? Will have a fruitful life. The person who lives in Christ, let me say it again, will have a fruitful life because of what they are sowing. But watch how Paul puts it in verse number 8. He says, for he that soweth to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit, of the Spirit shall reap life everlasting. Let me say this. No life in Christ will ever be fruitful when that life is not sown in the Spirit. Let me say that again. So I know some of you weren't looking at me, you weren't paying attention, you didn't hear it. You need to hear this. No life in Christ will ever be fruitful when that life is not sown in the Spirit. Amen? Because I'm not talking about this. Here's the problem. James said, we need to be not only hearers of the word, but doers of the word. Amen? Amen. That's what we need to be. But here's the misconception there. The falsehood thinks that everybody in here should be doing a work to gain some type of credit. There is no credit based upon your works. Amen? You can't do more to do more. Amen? I can't do more Christian life to make my, to be able to do more sinful life. Amen? See, it's not talking about soul winning. Amen? Paul's not talking about tithing. You can't give yourself out of sin. Amen? Let me say that again. You can't give yourself out of sin. You can't give yourself, you can't draw that 10% up. You can't write that check and get yourself out of the trouble that you're in. Amen? This is not talking about your role within a church. Doesn't matter if you're the pastor. Doesn't matter if you're the deacons. Doesn't matter if you're a trustee. Doesn't matter if you're an elder. Doesn't matter if you hold the door. Doesn't matter if you teach Sunday school. You can't do it. Because you can't do one thing and expect to get a different result. We've learned this concept over and over and over in our lives. We should have learned this as elementary school kids, but I found that sometimes we sow one thing and get a different result because we didn't sow the right thing. When Sydney is this, what I like to call a pseudo farmer. She's pretty good at it. She's got a green thumb. Now, I got the black thumb. That's why I get to weed eat afterwards. Amen? And she has a green thumb, and she likes corn, and I like corn. We like, is it peaches and cream? We like peaches and cream. I don't know if you've ever had it. It's the best corn there is. It's sweet. It has, it's white and yellow checkered all over. Amen. Now, there is one that we have established that we do not like. That is the Silver Queen. It's white, flavorless, and her mama loves it. Now, my mother-in-law, a few years ago, she went to Green's Feed and Seed, and she went and picked up the seed. She picked up peaches and cream for Sydney, and she picked up for her and my father-in-law, she picked up the Silver Queen. So they brought it over, and we had just tilled the ground and did all of that stuff, and they started to plant. Her and Sydney got in there, and they made 5 rows of beautiful, succulent peaches and cream. And they made 2 rows of the Silver Queen. So we get a little bit longer into the season. The stalks start rising up and then start pointing up to heaven, waving, just ready to be picked. We go through picking. And we start, and if you've never picked corn, you're missing a good time. Because you just grab it, pull down, and throw it behind you. It is so fun. I like to get in there while Sydney's doing it. I get the basket and run behind her going like this. It's so much fun. Now, if you take a corn cob to the face, now that's a little awkward, all right? But, so we finish up and we start shucking the corn. And we started noticing, Miss Shelley, that there was more Silver Queen. You like Silver Queen? Oh, Lord help you. Then there was peaches and cream. And we figured out, after some basic Sherlock Holmes work, that the bags got flipped. And we were sowing over here, hoping we were going to reap what we liked, but we were sowing the wrong seed, and therefore we reaped the wrong thing. There's a lot of people that come to this church on Sunday morning, amen, amen, who's been sowing seed all week long, and they come in here on Sunday expecting to reap something better than what they've been sowing. They haven't been reading the Bible. They haven't been praying. They haven't been preparing. They haven't been asking God to help them in any manner. They've been living their life as they diddly well pleased, expecting God to honor them. That don't work, honey. It never has, and the Bible says it never will. So let's go on. That was fun, amen. See, it's formulated on the soil to give fruitful sowing. And then we find in verse number 9 that there is seasons, and some seasons are faintable seasons. It said, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. Seasons. Now, we all know what seasons are, amen? We've got fall, we've got winter, we've got spring, we've got summer, we've got football season, baseball season, basketball season. Our church has a lot of seasons in it. We've got wrestling season. Now you're just preaching, preacher. We've got cheerleading season. We got every season. We got golf season. We got bowling season. We got hunting season. We got fishing season. We got seasons over here. We got seasons over there. We got bow season. We got gun season. We got the holiday season. And here's my favorite, typical white girl season. Amen. And some of you are so thankful for Starbucks across the road. They've got more money out of this church than anybody, than any offering we've taken in years. Solomon knows all about seasons. And Ecclesiastes 3:1, he said, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. I believe it was the Grammy-winning artist, The Birds, who said there's a season, turn. Now, I know some of you's like, I know that song. I miss some of the rap songs the preacher tells us about, but I got that one, amen. You see, but there is a season that I call the faintable season. This is the season when things are harder. Have you ever had a season where things just seem, I mean, everything seems smooth sometimes. Everything seems easy sometimes. But there are some seasons that just feel a little bit harder than others. I have experienced this in a physical way in my life. Since I was a seventh grader in high school, how about that? That's talent. Amen. I probably should have been seventh grader when I was in high school. She got that on video. It's on YouTube. Everybody knows now. Preacher was a seventh grader when he graduated high school. That was just my reading level. What was I talking about? Every year in August, and this is still true today, my body is conditioned. I lose 10 random pounds in August. And I believe this is the fact, because every year in August, my body used to get a shock. Because all summer long, I'd sit around, eat bologna and cheese, and watch Wings on TV. And then, come August the 1st, I'd go up to Johnny Lipscomb's up at DuPont Junior High, and they'd make me run until I threw up. Then I'd have to pick up the throw up and run again. I'd lose 10 pounds. Then I got Dick Whitman, who made us run gassers. And I don't know if you know what a gasser is, but it's a timed event. And if you're fat and slow, you got to run them over. Some days I had to run them over. Some days I didn't. But every August, I lose about 10 pounds still to this day. But some seasons I found were harder because I did less in the summer. My junior year, I did a lot so that I could be a starter in high school and all the girls would be like, yeah, he's a starter on the football team. My senior year, I didn't do a thing. I was reaping the benefits of all the work last year. I knew going into the season I was going to be the primo, supreme dog. I didn't have to do anything. So I walked into practice out of shape. About 2 weeks in, we were into two-a-days and had our pads on. I had a heat stroke on a Monday because I wasn't prepared for the season. Because I reap what I'd sown all summer long. You can't come into your Christian life expecting to get something when you didn't do anything. You said a while ago, preacher, that you can't do and get. But again, you have to do something to get something. I'm saying what you're doing is what you're going to get. Your Christian walk will predicate your Christian life. You have to live in Christ. But you see, those hard seasons can be overcome. You see, Paul says this, makes the point even clearer in three ways. He said, even when you're doing good things in this world, it can be hard. He said, weary in what? Well doing. How many times have you ever come to church? You've attended church, you've done Sunday school, you've done children's church, you've volunteered here, you've done this, and then a trial hits you. And you've been put in a test, in a strain, and you want to give up. You see, even when you're doing things that are good, it doesn't necessarily mean that things will be good. But we know this, that God works all things for our good. You see, here's the problem, though. It comes down to God's timing. Paul says, in due time. Not in you time, amen? It's in God's time, in due time. Everything brings us to this point based upon what God wants. He has in motion things in your life that you don't even know yet. But you are desiring an end result right now, and you're saying basically, God, I don't trust you to work all these things for my good. You say, but if he could just hurry, I know because I'm there with you. If he could just hurry up a little bit, it'd make everything a little bit more fun, right? But he says, I got to work it out. I've got to put the cogs in motion to get us to this point. And he says this, for I know the thoughts that I, then Jeremiah, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. And then this is one of my favorite things in all the Bible. To give you an expected end. You know why I like that so much? Because the Bible doesn't say a surprise ending. He brings it to an expected. It means he had it all planned all along. He didn't look into your life and he didn't look at you and see something that he could not love. He didn't look at you and see something that he cannot make better. He didn't look at you to make your life hell. He's working for your good. And let me give you this last thing. You see, after the faintable seasons and the fruitful sowing and how it's formulated in the soil of you, he gives us one more truth about living in Christ. And this is an action again. Something that we need to do. In verse number 10 it says, and as we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. You see, there are faintable seasons, times of hardship. There is fruitful life based upon the soil that it's planted in. But then, there is time for faithful service. You see, the one thing Paul wants us to leave with is that every person needs to be faithful in the service of Jesus Christ. Amen. Faithful service is not about attending service. Can I say that again? It's not about attending a church service. It's not about you reading your Bible from cover to cover within a year. Amen. It's not about you checking off some check mark on an app so that your buddies can see it on Facebook. Amen. I don't even know what that means. I heard somebody say it once. Thought it sounded good. Amen. It's not predicated upon your activities within the service. It's based upon your actions outside of the service. One of the greatest Christian leaders in American history is a man named D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody, when he got saved, he said, I'll never go to sleep without witnessing to somebody. After doing a revival in downtown Cincinnati, he went to his room where he'd been staying with a couple within the organization he was working with, and he was going to bed. And he was having a hard time going to sleep, and he couldn't get comfortable. And God brought to his mind a thought. You didn't keep your promise to me, D.L. He said, I sprung out of my bed in my pajamas, threw my overcoat on, tossed my hat on, and in my slippers while it was snowing, I walked the streets looking for somebody to tell about Jesus. He said, I walked around the city for it felt like hours. And I came to a man smoking a cigarette against a light pole. He walked over to the man and he said, sir, how are you doing? Now that's a way of really starting a good witness. He didn't come at him and go, do you know about Jesus? You're going to hell, aren't you? Amen. That's the Baptist way. He goes in there and he begins to talk to this man and he begins to encourage him and he finds out everything about him. And after about an hour of talking to this man, he brings him to a point where he has to make a decision. He told him about Jesus. And there at 3 a.m., the famous preacher who spoke to 5,000 people without a microphone at one time, who would stand in and preach the gospel 3 to 4 times a day to thousands and thousands of people, thought it was in his best interest to keep his word to God and tell one person personally about Jesus. You see, what an amazing story that is. Everybody in here wants to be a D.L. Moody and tell people about Jesus. But the one thing that we need to realize is that the opportunity for us to say something isn't always there. But there is an opportunity within the church. He said this, Paul said, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Now, I sure did like that. When I read that, my mind went from D.L. Moody and this thought over here, and I was like, man, I'm going to teach on soul winning tonight. And then Paul made me flip my mind around because he didn't put the emphasis on the soul winner. He went to the friend winner. He said, you've been given a family, and it's called the local New Testament church. And there are crazy, messed up people inside of that church that needs another crazy, messed up person to throw their arms around them and tell them that it's going to be okay. You had a hard day today, but you're still breathing. You had a hard day today, but your eyes are still open. You had a hard day today, but your ears are still hearing. Hey, you still got something inside of you. There's still hope for tomorrow. That's what we need, is some friend winners, some people of fellowship within the church. You see, when I'm looking for somebody to take a position in our church, I don't look for people who are doing nothing. You ever heard of those people? I'll do anything you ask, preacher, but you don't do nothing. Amen. Amen. I'll do anything you ask me to, but you don't want to really do anything, because when somebody asks you to do something, you don't want to do that. And if you do that, you only do it halfway. Sorry, I just got honest for a minute. I'll come back, I promise. You see, if I'm looking to add a pastor, I want to look for a pastor in this church. I want to look for a pastor who's already working. Amen. Who has a heart for people. You see, what I'm tired of is preachers who can stand behind a pulpit and never stand beside of a casket. Amen. I'm tired of preachers who can tell you that you can ask them anything you want to, but never going to get an answer from them. Amen. I'm not down with that. Amen. I don't want deacons that can't throw their arms around somebody and say, I love them. Who only show up for church when they want to or when it's convenient for them. Because nobody knows you love them if you ain't there to love on them. I don't want Sunday school teachers that don't notice when people are missing. Let me say it again. I don't want Sunday school teachers that don't notice when people are missing, because you cannot disciple people if there ain't no people to disciple. Because part of discipling is one-on-one communication. Jesus would hang out with his disciples in the fire after the masses were gone. After he got out of the pulpit, he took the 12 aside and began to break down what he said. Why? Because those 12 would be the 12 that he'd build something with. That's what discipleship's about. So that those 12 can get more 12s, to get more 12s, to get more 12s. I don't know about you, but I think it'd be all right if every one of us in here would turn in to servants instead of just save people in the pew. And we just decided, instead of saying, I'll do anything you want me to, you just do anything. Just do anything. Let me tell you what. You're going to go to Kroger's or Walmart, whichever one you prefer, because that's pretty much all you got, and a fast check every now and then. And there's going to be a little lady that's going to be ringing you up. And you've got a choice. You can stand there with your cell phone in your hand ignoring her today. Or you can look at her and be the only nice words she's going to hear. That's service. And then be like, oh, by the way, I got this church down on Chesterfield. You ought to come see us. And your niceness will win more people to Christ than anything, than any brow-beating, leather lung, spitting fire, hell-bent preacher there is. Because love always wins out. Faithful service. Fellowship is what we need in our church today. But the fellowship that we need is that everybody in here becomes a servant to everybody in here. Amen? A life in Christ isn't always easy. Sometimes you have seasons of fainting. Still a servant. And you'll grow when you sow. Sow in the Spirit, because you'll reap in the Spirit. With every head bowed and every eye closed and nobody looking around, I just want to take a little bit of time here just to speak with you on this matter.
Jesus. Hey guys, I want to say thank you for watching our video. Our service is coming to an end, but we wanted to take a few minutes just to talk to you. We understand here at Truth Baptist Church that not everybody who watches our videos has accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. And we want to invite you to accept Him today. You see, everybody was born a sinner. But Christ died for that sinner. No matter what you did, how bad you are, how bad you think you are, what your past may have been like, all that matters is your future. And to get to your future, it's what you do right now. We invite you to ask Jesus into your heart today. By simply praying. The Bible says that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's that simple. We'd like you to pray that prayer, just simply confessing your sins and ask Him to come into your heart. And if you're watching at home right now and you say, I've already been saved, well, we hope that the service has challenged you to be a better Christian. And maybe your prayer should be taking one of the topics that we talked about and asking God to move into your heart and to set you up and to put you in the right pathway. Our hope is that you connect with us in some way by emailing us or Facebooking us and just saying, hey, we enjoyed the message today. Hey, I got saved today. Our goal at Truth Baptist Church when we live stream is to help other people. And we would like to hear from you. And we'd like to help you further. We'd like to even have you join our online discipleship program. So, but nothing's better than coming live. So we'd love to see you. Our church starts every Sunday at 10:30 for Sunday school, 11:05 for morning worship, Sunday night service. Yes, we still do that. It's 6 o'clock. And we even do Wednesdays. You could come join us at 7 o'clock on Wednesdays. We would love to have you. And I promise you, you'll feel at home. Thank you.